Hi, I'm Susan. I'm from Worldpeacefull, and this is the ninth video in the bullying series. What I'll be questioning in this video is perception true? It's going to be very exciting because we all believe our perceptions and our beliefs. Very seldom do we seriously question what we perceive, and yet at the heart of conflict is often misperception. I can recall being told a story where there was a white room and I was asked to imagine I was suspended from the ceiling in that white room and there was nothing in the room. So I couldn't see distance from myself to the wall. I couldn't get any form of comparison until something was added to the room. So let's say, for example, in the background, a picture was added. Suddenly I get distance. Suddenly I get size, shape, colour. And what this does is slowly, slowly, I start to define myself. My shape is different. My colour is different. This is how my perception alters. Then more things are added to the room. A lounge. Then we get the depth of colour there. Again, shape. And I define myself in relationship to those additional things that have been added. And this is really how self-definition occurs. Any sort of environment will impact on how you define yourself. So perception is really, really interesting. And that's why there's so much work done on improving environment. And of course, the sort of work that I'm involved in is the inner environment and how that's shaped and contoured by the outer environment. And that is also mastered, if you like, by the belief system in the mind. It's very, very interesting what we believe we see. What we see, we believe. But what you believe you see is a really, really interesting part of this. So I thought I'd start off with some really, really interesting pictures that some of you may well have seen before. But they're a very great way of gaining a sense of what we notice and what we don't. So I'll stand up. Some people might recall this picture. How many faces are in the picture? Some say one, some see two, some may see three. There's actually three in here. So let me point out to you. The first face is female. Can you see her chin, her nose, her eyes? There's her hair, her ear. Can you see that? Her hat. That's the first image. Now, can you see the old lady in the image? There's her eye. There's her nose. Can you see her nose? There's her mouth. There's her chin. She's also wearing a hat. And that's her hair. Can you see the third image of the Scotsman? The Scotsman. There's his eye. There's his nose. There's his mustache, there's his mouth, there's his hat. So that's the third image. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about this image. I've got some interesting psychology, so I'm going to be drawing on that. So I might just fold that and hold it like this so that you can follow what I'm saying. In the figure, you may see a young lady with a bonnet looking away. So that was the first image. Now try to find another way of interpreting the same image, an old woman looking down and to the left. This picture can be seen in one of two ways. Now, the picture I'm talking about in this book that I'm reading doesn't have the Scotsman. This is just the two images, just the young girl and the old lady. Now, they call this perceptual bistability when you can see things in two ways. Poets can see things in two ways, because what we look for is we see how we can use words in two ways quite often. It's not unlike a picture, but I tend to do it with words because I'm a poet. The lines on the page are consistent with two very different interpretations. When you stare at the figure, you'll see one version, and then eventually the other, and then the first again, and so on. Here's the important part. Nothing on the physical page changes. So whenever a person reports that the image has flipped, it has to be because of something that has changed inside his or her brain. The moment he or she sees the young lady or the old woman, the brain has made a decision. A decision doesn't have to be conscious. In this case, it's a perceptual decision by a person's visual system. And the mechanics of the switchover are hidden completely under the hood. In theory, a brain should be able to see both the young lady and the old lady at the same time. So looking at this picture, the three images, the young lady, the old lady, and the old man, the Scotsman. In reality, a brain doesn't do that. Reflexivity, it takes something ambiguous and makes a choice. Eventually, it remakes the choice, and it might switch back and forth over and over. But our brains are always crushing ambiguity into choices. So when a man's brain or woman's brain lands on an interpretation of the young lady or the old woman, or the old man in this case, we can listen to the responses from a small number of neurons. Some leap into a high state of activity. Popo, popo, pop, is what it says. That's funny. While other neurons slow down. Pop, 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 pop. It's not always about speeding up and slowing down. Sometimes neurons change their patterns of activity in more subtle ways, becoming synchronized or desynchronized with other neurons, even while maintaining their original pace. The neurons we happen to be spying on are not by themselves responsible for the perceptual change. Instead, they operate in concert with billions of other neurons. So the changes we can witness are just a reflection of a changing pattern taking hold across large sweeps of brain territory. When one pattern wins out over the other in a person's brain, a decision has been landed upon. It's interesting, isn't it? Because you're not consciously seeking to see those two images. Something pops out at you and then recedes back. And if you look differently, you see another way. So again, looking at the old woman, see the mouth, the chin, her eyes. Now you're focusing in on that now. Now we wipe that and we go straight to the young woman. See her chin, her eyes. That's her ear there, and her hair. Suddenly you can see she's looking off in this direction. Now note your perceptual shift. The image itself has not changed. It is your brain, in a sense, tuning to different images. Now we live in complex environments, and I've talked about in a previous video how we have selective perception. And if we're trained to think in a certain way, that's why I sort of spoke of the, you know, see it and then you believe it. So I'm showing you, so you're seeing it and then you believe it. There are two images. Or we can look at things in another way, believe it and then see it. And that can also be education. My education trains me in order to see something. Now, what I've always been curious about is what about all the things we're not able to see because we've never been taught? Now, I'm not sure if this story is true or not, but let's just say it's interesting. And maybe we can just utilize it as a springboard to higher thought. I believe that when Christopher Columbus was going to the Americas, there were Indians on the beach. And all they could see was some water, some choppy water happening. They couldn't see anything else. But there was a medicine man on the beach. Now, possibly because he moves in and out of perceptual states, altered states of awareness, he may have a heightened way of seeing. But it turns out that he actually started looking at this wake of water, you know, breaking. And then he started to look in a different way and he saw the actual ships coming. No one could see the ships. So once he started to see the ships and he started to describe to the other Indians, it's a ship. Can you see that? Or it's a object floating on the water. They wouldn't have known. I mean, they would have had canoes. so boats. So in their language, I'm not even sure how it would be articulated. See, perception, language, all these filters, these are filters through which we see. We all believe that what we perceive and think is true. So it's extremely important that we question it. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you some perceptual pictures just to sort of challenge your thinking and beliefs. Very fascinating stuff. So what I'll do is put it on. I'm going to start with this one. Let's have a look. I'll stand up so you can see it. I'll try and make it all nice and level. Now, are those lines, the parallel lines, are they straight or are they crooked? These lines, they're straight. They're straight. Can you see? But the images, because of the way they've been staggered, gives the impression that these lines are actually skewed. Now, they're not skewed. Again, a perceptual trick. Now, I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see this very well, but I'm going to try and set it up in such a way that maybe you can. Now, looking without blinking at this image, you may see the dots possibly blinking. I'm not sure how the video works with this because the naked eye will definitely see them flashing. So it may or may not work, but I'll check it later after this video is finished. So that's another. So let's have a look at this one as well. See what you think. So even my adjusting of this in the video is my perception trying to work out what's parallel. You should be able to see invisible dots blinking. And that's by just staring at it without blinking yourself. You will blink, and that's okay. Now here I'll show you another one which is interesting. Okay. See that one. What does that look like to you? Does it appear to be a spiral? If I was to say to you, they're just circles. It's not a spiral. This one's a really interesting one too. So put it that way. I'll put it this way. You see that? Now, when you look at that, what can you see? What if I was to say the word liar? Oops. You see the L? I-A-R. Can you see that? It's liar. Now, what happens? If I turn this image, I'm just going to turn this image this way. Let's just turn it that way. Can you see? Try and straighten that up. Can you see the glasses? Can you see the nose and the lips? Chin, neck, shoulder. It's now a man. Interesting, isn't it? So liar, a man. But given, I mean, for those of you who have been watching my series of videos, do you remember I talked about the children that were raised by wolves? Now, they wouldn't have seen the word liar in there. Would they have seen the man's face? I doubt it. So it's education which shape changes what we see. Perceptual work is very, very important because it opens a space. What I call infinite possibilities is really just opening a space that I could be wrong. Now, being wrong is not a diminishment. As I've said to children when I was teaching peace, I said, what's the most intelligent thing that you can think? And of course, the kids say, I don't know. Close. I could be wrong. One of the most wonderful things I've ever heard is I could be wrong. Now, the minute I hear anybody say, I could be wrong, this is my perception, I know that they're very intelligent people. Because the minute you open your mind to the possibility, you may not know it all. You're actually then opening the mind to start to search for possibilities. This is what infinite possibilities is about. It's stepping outside of the known universe that we've created through our conceptual training, through our education. And because these thoughts have been trained into us since childhood, it sinks back into our subconscious as the norm. We think it's normal because we can't step outside and then look back at ourselves and question what it is we're perceiving and seeing and believing. So I'll show you another one, which is a really interesting one, this one. See this? Now, can you see these two circles, that one and that one? Which one is smaller? Which one is bigger? Have you made a decision? What if I told you they're both the same size? It is just the circles around it that give it the impression, because of the negative space in there too, that this one looks bigger. It's actually not bigger. So therefore, you know, that's the nature of perception. Very powerful stuff. Now, when I was teaching in schools, I also did a blind spot test. I had little cards, actually, and I gave them out to all the children. This is part of my awareness session. I was teaching Real Hope, so responsibility, empathy, awareness, love, honesty, oneness, peace, enjoyment, and service. And the awareness part was really looking at what are we aware of. So this is, as you can see, two dots, well, a cross and a dot. You could have two dots if you wanted to. And basically, you're looking at the dot, you're covering your right eye and looking at the opposite dot, right? So that would be on my left. So if I was looking at this, I would be covering my eye in order to look at the dot. Now, what happens is when you cover your eye and you look at that dot, look through your peripheral vision at the cross. So look at the cross through your peripheral vision and you'll notice that it disappears. Now you can pause this and play with that idea. But essentially, the idea is when you cover your eye and you look at that opposite dot, the other one will just disappear because there's a blind spot in the eye. Now, what that means, and this is the way I teach it, is when you think you're right, you will only see the one dot. The other one disappears, so the other side of the argument disappears because you're only focusing on a specific point and you're right. So everything disappears. So when we have an open mind, we would know that it's a mind trick that the other side disappears. So we would then consciously seek to look at the cross. This is through teaching people to be open-minded. I'm going to show you another really interesting one too. It's one of my favourites. This is Escher. He's a wonderful artist. Now, can you see the fish? See all the fish all swimming in one direction? They're getting lighter as we go higher. And then they start to turn into, see these black swans? Can you see? They become swans flying and then we've got it here. Oh, they're actually ducks. Can be ducks, swans, whatever. Doesn't really matter. But you can see if you just look at through your perception, look at the fish, then look at the ducks or geese. I'm just working out what it is. What is that? Is that a goose? I think it's a goose. It's geese. Amazing, isn't it? Escher's really fantastic if you want to really look into perceptions. He did the Impossible Staircase. That was a very interesting one as well. He would have had a very right brain consciousness. So he was seeing, you'll see that with artists. Spent many years with an artist who was a surrealist painter. And he was able to do images within images in amazing ways. And those who looked at another one of my videos would have remembered this picture. He painted this. He spent hours, he said, looking up at the clouds, trying to get them right. If you can see that really well. But again, this is perception as well. See, it just looks like ruins, but it's not. It's a city. The city is the man. And there's a shoulder and there's the arm and there's the leg. But the city's in, or the man is in ruins because it's self-destruction. War is self-destruction in this case. And the shadow is reaching out for this baby that's in a helmet on a wall, very precariously balanced. Baby could tip either way. So artists, you know, often they get sort of dismissed as idealists. You know, they're often the poorest in society because society doesn't actually value what artists have to contribute. Yet what they're really offering is another form of intelligence, another way of seeing, and often it's in multi-dimensions. So it's not just simply reading and then through factual information repeating that in a rote fashion. It's about utilizing perception in order to see the depth in things. When I write poetry, I find that I get insights that flash in. If I start with an original intent of truth, I have no idea what I'm going to write. I just start writing and I get into the feeling of what I'm writing. And truths come in. It's really fascinating. And there's a rhyming aspect to it, which is kind of like a symmetry. It's like singing, but you're kind of singing with a symmetry happening here. That's what the rhyming is all about. It's finding some form of joining. It's really interesting. It would be really fascinating for someone to actually really study the power of perception through art. Now, I'm going to show you another one that's really interesting as well. Okay, there's actually, in this one, I don't know if you can see, a man's head in the beans. So I'll see if I can straighten that up a bit. Can you see, sorry about the glow on it, bit of reflection. Can you see the man's head in the beans? Pause it, and then I'll tell you what it is. See here? Can you see the man's face? Can you see his, move a bit closer? Even I'm finding it a bit hard to see. I might just liberate it. Oh, here we go. I've got another one. I've got a bigger one. Let me see. I will find it for you. It's very tricky. It can be very, very tricky. Yeah, there it is. You can see it here. Okay, look at this one. This one may not have glare on it. So can you see this man? Can you see the man here? His nose? His eyes? Can you see? He's amongst the beans. So that gives you a little bit of a feel. Now, you're not off the hook yet because I'm going to show you some more interesting stuff. Edward de Bono was very much about creating techniques. He was very popular in corporate circles, one of the top 50 thinkers in the world. And what he was teaching business people was to see laterally. He was trying to, you know, he had things like the six thinking hats, which is parallel thinking. So you put on the critical hat together and you look at an issue. You look at, you know, the facts might be the white hat, you know. Optimism could be the red hat. I'm not quite sure of all the colours now. I'd have to go back and think. So every colour of the hats represented a way of looking at a problem, but together. So you're not kind of coming at each other at odds, but you're actually thinking in a parallel fashion. And he found that very powerful. So learning to think differently, creatively, actually changes what we see, and it breaks out of boxes, breaks the box thinking, where we're so used to thinking in a certain way that's never been challenged. And if someone challenges us, typically we feel threatened rather than excited. In a true, you know, situation of intelligentsia, you should get excited when you're challenged, because it's like, oh wow, that's another way of seeing. I didn't think of that. How exciting, because I'm really here to learn to expand myself. This is the expansion of, you know, creativity, expanding the horizon of knowledge, awareness, bringing in lots of different intelligences so that we can play with seeing, how we can see the world. And honestly, the world shape changes for you as you choose to see differently. Again, as people may know, having looked at my videos, I'm a clown. That's most definitely a different way of seeing. I go out into the public with no thought happening, so I'm actually going out there without a story. And I simply look at the people. I might be juggling at the time, so my left and right hemisphere is in balance. It'd be good to, I'll juggle for you in one of my other videos I'll do in the future, because that's actually the infinity symbol when we're juggling. It's the figure eight, and it has an impact on how the brain is actually wired. Now, when I juggle, I can actually see through the juggling balls and look at you as I'm juggling. I don't have to look at the balls. That's because my feeling state is expanded. So there's lots of different ways to see in the world, and that's the beauty of mixing it up. If we mix society up and we're not just sort of creating cliques amongst people and saying, well, this is intelligent and this is not. Well, no, there's lots of different intelligences in the world, and it really does change everything. And in this time where we're facing unprecedented change in the world, where we are looking at ecological and economic collapse. Now, some people may be filled with fear at that thought. I'm filled with excitement, because what this is telling me is that there is, it's like a lightning strike hitting the earth and energizing everything. Everything's being thrown into topsy-turvy. The things that we had done by rote, the things that we were conditioned to believe, will be thrown into disarray. Now, for some, that's terrifying, and I understand that. But for people like myself, it's actually very exciting, because what it does is it opens up new vistas. It opens up new possibilities. We can reform, recreate, reconfigure. What I often use in my poetry is the Philosopher's Stone. And what I came to understand through poetry, because poetry was my teacher in truth, I didn't know a lot of the things I was writing about. It was coming to me through inspiration. So what I realized about the Philosopher's Stone was, when I was in a conflict with someone, I was actually reforming and reshaping myself based on my thinking. And I came to see that it was the stone and the hard edges of what I had believed that slowly changed as I confronted people with very different worldviews from me. So even in the midst of conflict, there is great opportunity for reformation of who you are. If you're open-minded, if you're willing to perceive things in a different light. I could have seen the other as, I could have judged them very negatively. I could have fought them. I could have really taken on a strong adversarial approach, but I didn't. I looked at them as teachers, and I asked myself, what am I here to learn from this situation? What am I feeling confronted about? What is upsetting me? What is in my thought patterns that I came to understand, you know, over many years, because I've been reforming myself for a long time. I came to understand that it was my own thinking that actually crafted the pain within me, because I was believing in powerlessness that was never true. And what I came to understand is, in a sense, the pain signal is a sign of being out of alignment with nature, being out of alignment with truth. This is universal truth, not factual truth. It doesn't mean that the person who is engaging in negative behavior, let's say it's bullying or whatever it is not doing that. They certainly are. So we're not denying the reality of the interchange or the interplay between people. But what we're doing is we're taking our power back. We're no longer the victim of a circumstance, but we become the creator of a new way. And we change ourselves in order to find the harmony. And this is why social harmony is a very great way of coming back to equilibrium. Social harmony is actually encoded into our DNA. That's why people are always seeking to work with others in many respects. Most people don't want to rock the boat. It's not that they're all conformists. It's just it's natural for people to want to get along and want to work together in harmony. Because we recognize on some very deep level that the survival of the tribe is dependent on that cooperation and harmony. It's a safe space, in truth. So that's just a little aside, but I'm going to show you something else. Now, these are interesting cards that I've got. These are lateral cards. Now, what the question here is saying is, and I'll just read it out for you. It says, Mr. and Mrs. Greengage are setting up a bed and breakfast business. They need to buy a new coffee pot and want to buy one which holds a large volume of liquid. Out of the two below, which one should they buy and why? So looking at these two, which would be the coffee pot that you would buy? Which holds more volume, do you think? Well, there is an answer on the back. I'll read it for you. The shorter coffee pot will contain the most coffee. See, most people would think the bigger one, wouldn't they? Its spout extends to the height of the pot. See, sprout. See where it's positioned? See where that's positioned? A bit of engineering here. Which means it can be filled to the top, whereas the larger coffee pot has a shorter spout, which will overflow as soon as the pot is filled above the level. It will overflow. So design, I think a lot of design engineers would be very lateral in the way of thinking. So let's have a look at this one. Okay, what we're going to do is look at this. I've got matches, and they're calling that a coin where the eye is of the fish. See, it's a fish. Now, if you wanted to turn the fish the other way, so it's swimming in the opposite direction, you would need to move three matches and the coin. Which three would you move in order to make it to turn the other way? So this is very lateral. And I'll show you the answer. You see, they've darkened the matches that have been replaced. So the light lines, the dotted lines, is where the matches were, and where they were moved to is the dark ones. And clearly you can see the coin moved over to here. Interesting, isn't it? So 1, 2, 3, move to 1, 2, 3. Conceptual imagining. And this is where imagination is really, really powerful for designing our way into a new future. We've got to start to think differently if we're going to create change in the world that brings peace and harmony to the planet. At the moment, we're living out the same old paradigms which don't work. The most important questions is not really to do with right and wrong, it's to do with what works and what doesn't. It's to become more practical. If something's not working, you change an end game if it's not working. You don't just sink the ship and extract everything and live it up until that ship sinks. If you're living real hope, you will take responsibility. You are part of the problem or you're part of the solution, you choose. Einstein said that you cannot change a problem from the same consciousness that created it. So I think it's exactly said, a problem cannot be solved by the same consciousness that created it, is the quote. That's why it's very important to listen to different voices. It's not all about those that we believe have all the answers. In truth, they don't have all the answers because we're still swimming in the same direction. We haven't turned that fish around. We're still stuck in mind patterns that we believe are the right ones, but we've got to learn to think differently. So I'm going to show you another one. It's really interesting. So if we look at this, can you see the top? And you'll see there's a question mark down the bottom. And what it's saying is, which symbol in the top series of six boxes would you put in that bottom row? Which is the logical choice? And interestingly enough, the answer is that one. So let's go back, you'll see it. See? It's that one. You can see they're all triangles, aren't they? You can see that there's darker ones, darker one, see the circle, the square, and then obviously the logical pattern would be the triangle that's thickened. They're all squares, they're all circles. So maybe just examine what your perception was. It's no right and wrong, it's just perception. It's just the way we're choosing to see. We're the ones that call it logical or not. I always remember when I had a debate with Edward de Bono I actually wrote to him many years ago, and when I was an economics student at Griffith University, and I was very cheeky, and I can be cheeky. You know, I have clown persona deep down, not even deep down, it's actually not far from the surface. I actually contain it. But I remember I did a picture, and it had, it's like there were 2 points I was making. I was being cheeky with that. And I also talked about the 6 thinking hats, and I said there was a 7 thinking hat, and it was reversed, like, you know, baseball hat backwards. Anyway, on the basis of what I wrote to Edward, he obviously was intrigued, and I said that he should have scholarships available for lateral thinking economics students who have no money. And to my surprise, he rang me at home. He invited me to come to his conference, which was $400 a head. And I just laugh at me when I think of the thoughts that I had. I thought I'd be up on the stage. No, I was in the audience. See my perception? Completely erroneous. Anyway, I had to listen to Edward give his talk to the audience. And then he and I met up in the break and we had a coffee together. Anyway, I always hope I remember this correctly because it's been a long time now and I've always told the story the same way, but there is a point to it. What I recollect is him saying there was 10 doors and there was a goat behind one of the doors. And he said, what's the probability of getting the goat behind the door? Now, anyone who's done probability theory would say 1 in 10, 1 chance in 10 of getting the goat behind the door. I actually said at the time, 50-50, either get it or you don't. And he disagreed. And I said, oh, well, we'll have to agree to disagree. And today, of course, I've even got it, even my perception has changed even more, where only in as far as articulating what I actually mean by that, because now it's bearing out in experience. What I would say is there's a 0 or a 1 on off. And I would say you either get the goat and behind the door, you're meant to get the goat behind the door, or you're not. So what I really am saying is that there's no probability, there's no chance. It's either meant to be or it's not. Now, some could say, well, how can you say it's either meant to be or it's not? This would be an argument for, is our life happenstance, or is there some form of blueprint to our life? I've certainly had experiences. I remember when I moved to England, I had deja vu on the way from the airport. I also remember staring out a window in the middle of London and looking out at what always comes into my mind is like a New York skyline. I don't know why that thought was there, but I recognized the place and I thought, I've been here before. Now, I've had these sorts of experiences in my life where I recognize that even people, I've met people and I think, I know you. When I met my husband, it was the same thing, I knew him. So there are lots of unexplainable things that we can't just logically flick out. There, of course, is an intelligence and an order to the universe. Of that, I have no doubt. And I have no doubt that mathematics comprises the universe. That everything, you know, has a logical aspect, but it has a creative aspect. And it's the opening of one's own mind to the possibilities of being able to see in a myriad of ways. Even in disputation, I see it as a growth experience, even though I've suffered terribly. Through an experience, it's given me an opportunity to look into the nature of that discord, and that will make me a better peacemaker. I'm here to assist others in seeing differently in order to restore a sense of harmony. And that, of course, has an impact on the entire situation of the planet, really. I mean, if all thought is electromagnetic, then all our thoughts are, in a sense, creating the very world that we are seeing or perceiving. The media is a very good example of that. A lot of conditioned mind patterns are generated through media images. And if you're watching them over and over in repetition, you will see and then believe. And you might look out into the world and think it's a very scary place because you've frightened yourself so much with so much negativity. But when you live a life where it's very positive, I've always been a positive person. My nature is positive, but I've had challenges throughout my life with people who haven't been positive, who have had low self-esteem deep down, but they may well come across as the bullying type, or they may exclude, or, you know, there may be some negative attitudes, which I've come to understand today are just reflective of inner states of unhappiness within those others. It has nothing actually to do with me. But still, I'm still learning to disregard what I've been taught as well about my own sense of self. And again, how I perceive myself when I look in the mirror, how I perceive myself given the job I'm doing, how I perceive myself as a female, what sort of outcomes, you know, come from that. You know, where do I take myself? Where do I believe I can go as a result of how I see myself? So as you can see, perception is extremely powerful, and that's why a lot of the positive thinking people in the world, or those who have come from some form of altered experience, will state that, you know, particularly more enlightened types will say, what you believe you will see. So if we change our belief systems from negative to positive, you will see different outcomes. And I know that in my own personal experience, again, as a clown, you know, when I've moved into spaces with a great big smile and I've really connected with people, that mirrors back to me from the world that I'm looking at. It mirrors me. So I've come to see the way you treat people will be mirrored back to you. So in many respects, natural justice always occurs, because whatever you do to the world comes back. And I often say, what you resist persists, what you look at disappears. So the resistance to something will actually keep it coming back to your door. And the more you give it attention, the more you resist it, the more it comes. That's why, you know, conflict, when it's adversarial, actually maintains that state of tension more. Whereas if you look at it for what it is, and I know the work of Byron Katie would say without a story, the actual problem that you think you're looking at will actually disappear. And again, that's like the blind spot test. It depends on how you choose to see. It's very, very powerful. I'm lucky in that I've cultivated within myself a way of seeing beauty, and I believe what I see is real, actually. When I'm clowning on the streets, because I don't have time to think, I can't bring in a filter. So I actually look at people without a story. And as I've said in some of my other videos, what I've seen is absolute beauty. Even in the faces of people who, you know, have deformed faces or pock marks, or, you know, maybe they look physically not so nice, I've come to see them as beautiful. When I see someone smiling, that's more beautiful to me than the aesthetics of a good-looking face. When I see the warmth in eyes, nothing will bring tears to my eyes more than a beautiful, kind look from someone. For me, that's the true beauty of the world, and that's my perception. When I traveled the world, I've seen the world as a very, very beautiful place. I don't see it as dangerous at all. Therefore, I don't generate fear, and fear doesn't mirror back to me. So in truth, real safety, even if we're going to the OH&S area, health and safety, if you really want to create that, you have to create belief systems that are positive. We look for the good in things. We look for the lesson in it. We look for the outcome. We don't demonize and criticize, because what we do is we will create more of that back at us, and that's what toxic cultures are all about. So I think there's been an interesting exploration of perception. Give it some thought and feeling and decide what you believe is real. Is what you perceive true? Thank you very much for watching. I'm from World Peaceful. You can go to my website. It's www.worldpeacefull.com, or you can go to my business site and look at workshops. That's http://biz.worldpeaceful. And that's with the double L.com. Take care, and much love to you. Bye.